Il m'incombe le plaisir et l'honneur d'inviter, de monter à la tribune nos deux grands témoins de la journée, Mr. Neil Rose. Mr. Neil Rose is a qualified solicitor, a legal journalist for more than 20 years. He is the founder of and editor of Legal Future, and he works about the future of legal market and the future of our profession. And 2 years ago, he won the Legal Journalism of the Year Award of the Aylesbury Legal Award. Thank you to be here, and have a good journey, I hope. And Monsieur le Professeur Bruno Dondero. Monsieur le professeur Bruno Dondero est professeur de droit à l'Université Paris 1 et directeur du Centre audiovisuel d'études juridiques. Il a choisi effectivement de travailler sur les questions de nouvelles technologies au sein de l'université et pour également les études de droit. Donc c'est un professeur qui a créé une page Facebook où les étudiants peuvent poser des questions. Il a décidé d'utiliser le compte Twitter et son cours est annoncé sur Twitter. Il a privilégié une interactivité avec ses professeurs. Bref, moi j'aurais aimé être son étudiant, mais maintenant c'est un peu tard. Il a également écrit un livre que je vous conseille, qui s'appelle Le droit 2.0. Il a donc été immédiatement surnommé un professeur 2.0. Et ce livre a pour sous-titre... apprendre et pratiquer le droit au 21e siècle. Donc c'est vraiment tout un programme. Néanmoins, un petit reproche, monsieur le professeur, il paraît qu'à l'université, vous vous étiez posé des questions et vous dites dans un article, j'avais plus dans l'idée de devenir avocat. Bon, personne n'est parfait, mais vous auriez pu être un bon avocat. Ce sont donc nos deux grands témoins pour la journée. Ils pourront, à la fin de chaque table ronde, poser leurs questions, interpeller les intervenants concernant les questions qui ont été abordées par les intervenants et surtout sur les questions qui n'ont pas été abordées par les intervenants. Et je crois que maintenant vient la place de la première table ronde dont le modérateur est Panagiotis Perakis, qui est notre chairman du comité accès à la justice. C'est un comité au sein du Conseil des barreaux européens qui est extrêmement important et dont notre confrère grec Panagiotis Perakis mène avec beaucoup de talent parce qu'il y a beaucoup, beaucoup de travail. Et je veux signaler que le Conseil des barreaux européens est en train de terminer une étude comparative concernant l'aide légale dans toute l'Union européenne. Nous avons déjà une matière assez importante et l'année prochaine, il sera publié un ouvrage avec l'étude comparative, mais également avec des recommandations du Conseil des barreaux européens. Donc, place à la première table ronde sur le futur de la justice. Il va y avoir du travail.
Bonjour, mesdames et messieurs. On entre maintenant à la partie principale du programme. On se trouve à Paris, donc je vais essayer de commencer en français, après continuer en anglais. Autour de cette table sont assis avec moi Madame Tiina Astola. Elle est directrice générale, elle est en tête de la Direction générale justice des consommateurs de la Commission européenne. Monsieur Maurits Barendrecht, qui est directeur de recherche chez HiiL Innovating Justice. Madame Nuria Díaz, présidente du réseau européen du Conseil de la justice. Et Monsieur Jérôme Dupré, cofondateur de Case Law Analytics. Et on a une procédure. La procédure est la suivante. Comme vous le savez, il y a 4 séances, chacune avec son propre sujet. Dans chaque séance, il y aura une courte introduction par le modérateur et après les rapporteurs, les intervenants, c'est prévu, comme c'est prévu au programme, auront 7 à 10 minutes chacun. Et après leurs interventions, nous allons avoir une discussion sur le sujet de la séance auquel vous pouvez participer aussi. Et vous comprenez que le programme est assez lourd, donc la gestion du temps est très importante maintenant. Maintenant, je vais continuer en anglais. I continue in English now. The future of justice. I believe that all in this room we share too many questions about the future of justice, because it seems that the system of justice, which practically was the same during centuries, is going to change now. And according my point of view, the most radical change is that the system is going to meet the needs of the public, the needs of the citizens, and not the needs of its professionals, of the lawyers or the judges. There are many factors driving this, but it's mainly technology which is continuously replacing much of the current system with something new, always responding to people's needs. Information technology does not change only the material. Paper will soon disappear from judicial proceedings. We will have a justice totally paperless, which is a monumental change. But even more, information technology makes justice directly accessible to the citizens at their homes without anyone's intervention. A home delivery justice. Do we need new principles, new professional rules? How far we can go? Providing justice not by judges or lawyers, but by doctors, by engineers, or accountants? Could be that possible in the near future? By the computer itself, maybe, in some cases? How those changes will affect all of us, lawyers, judges, and mostly citizens? And mostly what will happen to their fundamental right for access to justice? What about equality before the law and non-discrimination? This future provides justice for all or produces new gaps? On all those questions, we will try now to find some answers. Mrs. Astola, the floor is yours.
Monsieur le Président, Mesdames et Messieurs, je remercie vivement d'être invité à cette conférence. Et je voudrais aussi remercier pour votre hospitalité d'hier soir. Je suis particulièrement heureuse d'être ici, Monsieur Benichou, car nous avons développé une excellente coopération avec le Conseil des barreaux européens que vous présidez. Et si vous le permettez, je voudrais aussi continuer en anglais. Speaking about future today is a difficult task. There are many who think that justice is a slow motion area, but during the past years we have seen dynamic developments across the EU. I have had the opportunity to witness this from two perspectives, from the Ministry of Justice in Finland and now from the Commission. And from my experience, my vision on the future justice relies on the following three convictions. First, it is my firm belief that justice will play a key role more than ever in our society. Justice systems will remain the guarantor of the common values that we have: democracy, rule of law, and fundamental rights. And upholding these values will be more than ever vital when fighting terrorism as was mentioned here by the minister before, addressing new societal changes and challenges, and also ensuring that the rising populism doesn't materialize in breaching fundamental rights. In the past years, we have witnessed certain challenges as regards the rule of law in member states of the European Union. And therefore, the Commission has established a rule of law framework precisely for defending the key role of the national rule of law safeguards, especially the judiciary, in case of systematic threat to the rule of law in a member state. But justice is also crucial for growth. An effective justice system is a key driver for an investment-friendly environment for the enforcement of EU law and mutual trust. And the role will be even more important with the new legislation which is in preparation in the Commission relating to digital contracts, insolvency, company law, all which work for the internal market. My second conviction is, as we have heard here already today also, that national justice systems will be more effective. And I don't think it's only a sign of optimism. It's also because in the EU, we are developing a policy encouraging member states to improve the effectiveness of their national justice systems. And it is one of the priorities of the European semester, which is the annual cycle of economic policy coordination. It's an important tool for political change. A large number of member states, and including France, are engaged in justice reforms, and it's a good possibility to learn from each other. To assist member states in this reform, the Commission has established the EU Justice Scoreboard, which provides every year comparative data and overview of the functioning of national justice systems. And also in this context, I would like to thank the Council for the cooperation in gathering data for the legal aid part of that scoreboard for 2016. But it is important to underline that effective justice is not about only about efficiency, it's not only about speed, it is about quality and independence. For instance, the EU Justice Scoreboard underlines the importance of having adequate human and financial resources for the quality of justice systems. And this is, of course, a challenge in the current economic context. And I'm very well aware of the discussions that are also going on here in France. So information and communication technologies are essential for the effectiveness of justice systems, but we should not be counting how many computers there are in the courts or only talking about the predictive justice. It is important to keep in mind the perspective of the end user of justice systems and to ask how the technology that we are using is really contributing the end user. We should focus on the end result and how we provide better transparency, quicker access to justice, efficient case management, and higher quality judgments. And my third belief is that the justice is becoming more European. Lawyers, judges work more with European law. The judges are, in a way, European judges when applying European legislation, whether it's based on a directive or might directly when they apply regulations. You know that there is a big package called General Data Protection Regulation, which will replace the 1995 directive, and there the courts would be applying directly the regulation. And there, of course, the training of the judges will be essential. And it will be more European also, because there will be more direct cooperation between the judges of different member states. The court has in its judgment, Aranjosi and Caldararo, clearly encourage courts to be in direct contact, and this related to a European arrest warrant. The court who was requested to give the warrant was asked to be in contact with the issuing court in order to know what the detention conditions in that state would be like. E-evidence is one of the future issues. And it doesn't only relate to cybercrime, because much of the evidence that is needed for all type of crime is really e-evidence. And we have relied on the mutual legal assistance agreements in these. Now we have to think whether there could be also alternative solutions. Finally, justice will be more European because lawyers are also more aware of cases in other member states. And the court has also, the European Court has also ruled that when there is frequent interpretation of the rules, and these are contradictory in different member states, the highest court should request for a preliminary ruling. And there, of course, the e-justice portal and judicial networks are important. But to conclude, ladies and gentlemen, the future of justice is not only creating a judicial environment. It is the work on the ground. And of course, you as the lawyers, you are in the front line there. You are making justice become true. And therefore, it's extremely important for the Commission to be able to continue cooperation with you in order to have justice and in order to have European justice policy. Thank you. Merci.
Thank you very much. I would like only to mention that the contribution of CCBE in the EU scoreboard, This is a collaboration we hope to continue and
okay. get Thank you very much. Yeah.
And now the floor to Mr. Maurits Barendrecht, Research Director of HiiL Innovating Justice. Please.
Thank you. I prefer to stand because I want to show a few slides as well, but I'm not sure how I can handle the slides from here.
There was a machine.
It's a machine and over there.
Technology is saving us. Bonjour, madame, messieurs, colleague lawyers. At an age of 25, I was wanting to help people with their legal problems. So I found three friends, and we committed to start a small law firm. But one after one, my friends came to me and said, Maurits, I'm very, very sorry about this, but I have a great offer from a major law firm. My girlfriend and I spoke about it, and we think that is a better future. But when we are 35, we have made some money, we will really start this law firm helping people together. So I also entered the legal profession in the traditional way. J'étais membre du comité exécutif du Jeune Barreau de La Haye. I helped people in need, but mostly companies. I made it to partner in the biggest Dutch law firm, Dupré. Le droit n'était pas une marchandise, but some money came in. My patron was the bâtonnier of the Dutch bar. He was later president of the CCBE. And I was thinking of him when I accepted your invitation. I'm now in my 50s, late 50s. To be frank, I will be 60 next month. And as a professor, and now as a director of an innovation institute, I'm still struggling with access to justice and the legal profession. These are justice needs of individuals. This is great research from Canada. And it shows these are not small problems for people. These are big problems in people's lives. They need solutions. And the situation is similar in every country. There's millions of problems. And when you look at the data, they are poorly served. This is very well researched. And there is dozens, maybe hundreds of access to justice task forces all over the world. Can the legal profession deliver justice to individuals? Let's look at the facts. I wonder, I can't see you all, but how many of you are working at a global law firm focusing at legal problems of individuals specializing in that? And I don't mean high-value individuals that you help through a divorce. No, I mean average citizens. Ladies and gentlemen, there is no global law firm serving individuals. There are, as far as I know, no national law firms in the world serving individuals on a large scale. I don't know how it is in your country, but I know a few countries. And most countries leave it to beginners to serve individuals. That's the second exhibit. And we also see what the legal profession does to serve individuals. They believe in their own model. They believe in the professional lawyer helping an individual person out. And they're right to believe so, because people are generally glad with their lawyer. They appreciate the help. They think he or she is professional. But on a large scale, what we do, we ask for legal aid money. And let's be frank, we object to many innovations in the court procedures. Fact number four. As an innovation institute, we attract a lot of attention from pro bono initiatives. But let's perhaps be frank about it. We have now promised for 30 years that pro bono would solve the problem. Perhaps we could solve the problem with online support. I'm not here to do an advertisement for something we developed in the Netherlands, but somehow it shows the future. It's a divorce application. It's enabling lawyers to help people. And there's a lot of helping people also by giving them information online. People like the experience. It's 2 points higher than what they now think of the average legal procedure around divorce in the Netherlands. And this is just an example of what these famous startups are trying. We talk to startups trying to help individuals worldwide. And these are really small startups, really small. It's individual people of 25 years wanting to change the world. But there's also some startups which are we are seeing for a long time. You have the mediation startups, legal expenses insurance startups. We have hybrid services where employment lawyers work together with HR professionals, that type of startups. Why do we not join forces with startups as a legal profession? The first question is whether we could attract investors. I have to leave quickly to catch a train because I have to talk to investors. I can't survive my platform and scale it up if I don't have investors. But is investor ownership allowed? We all know it's basically not allowed. Are hybrid co-owned services allowed? Can the divorce lawyers and the psychologists work together and build a great firm bringing divorce solutions together with IT people, sharing the risk, sharing the revenues, be co-owners of this firm? We all know that it's not allowed. Working for two parties. Luckily, in Holland, it's no problem that reviewer lawyers work on our platform and more or less advise two people, a couple. But in England, that's a big issue with the Bar Association. In most countries, working as a lawyer for two parties, giving legal advice, is not allowed, or at least difficult. Online legal advice allowed? We have found a country. We try to work and do our investigations worldwide. We have found a country somewhere overseas, and they talk there about unauthorized practice of law. Can you imagine? citizens are not allowed to practice the law. What is the rule of law? You're not allowed to practice it as an IT person, as a citizen. That happens in some countries. Law firms serving individuals, will they ever make it? Ladies and gentlemen, bar rules make it impossible to enter that market. They paint small law firms in a corner. I don't know the French for painting yourself in a corner, but that's actually what happens. It's a very poor business model that lawyers working for individuals have. It's leading to poverty in many countries. Bar rules are used to defend against startups. And in the end, that stifles innovation. Citizens suffer major injustice because of this situation. Moi, je ne suis pas Al Gore. Al Gore was somebody from the establishment bringing an inconvenient truth. And I think perhaps somewhere in this audience, there is somebody wanting to step forward from the establishment and bring this inconvenient truth. And then perhaps in a few years, we will be back in Paris. And we will get the result of fantastic legal diplomacy. Bar associations, courts, innovators will have joined together to solve the access to justice problem and build a new future. I'm a great believer in the dynamics of the French diplomacy that brought this together. I would love to come back to Paris to celebrate this rule of law accord. From an inconvenient truce to a Paris treaty, what is needed? We need to do honest analysis how to deliver justice for all. We have to build innovative justice journeys, starting with the users and their problems, a land problem, a family justice problem, and build it from there. We need bar rules that stimulate innovation and investment. Please, please take these bar rules that you currently have apart and build them new, and do that through co-creation. Ladies and gentlemen, let's innovate. Let's bring access to justice to all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Maurits, for this interesting speech, very interesting. And now, Mrs. Nuria. This is Nuria Díaz Abad, President of the European Network of Councils for the Judiciary.
Bon, merci. Merci, Monsieur le Président, pour cette invitation. Je suis très heureuse de pouvoir être aujourd'hui ici et de continuer notre collaboration entre le réseau européen des conseils de la justice et le CCBI. Maintenant, je veux changer en anglais. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. I will examine from the point of view of the bodies governing the judiciary first. What challenges and opportunities digital justice offers. Then I will pass to mention what changes in the way we all work will have to be introduced. And to finish my intervention, I would like to point out that at the end, a judge remains a judge, and he or she will have to stick to the same values that makes from a judge the cornerstone of the rule of law. In our Warsaw Declaration, in our last General Assembly, we pointed out that the ENCJ recognizes that the administrations of Europe's justice system in the 21st century will change radically as a result of the use of information and communication technology. So we come to a model towards a digital justice. The arriving of the digital era has made councils for the judiciary aware of the need to get involved in the process of adapting to these new changes. As the ENCJ is an association of the bodies governing the judiciary all around the European Union, I will concentrate my speech in the role councils for the judiciary play in this context. Councils for the judiciary mainly pursue four aims in this digitization process. First, increase the quality of justice. Secondly, increase the transparency of the justice system. Third, guarantee the interoperability of the different IT systems that converge in the digital system. And fourth, maintain the security of the digital judicial system. increase the quality of justice by improving the productivity and efficiency of the judicial system. We have to consider that one of the indicators of a quality justice system is a timeliness justice. The internal functioning of a judicial system has to adapt to the possibilities offered by the new technologies so as to achieve a more speedy way to conduct the proceedings and facilitate the presentation of documents before the courts. To organize this system, two characteristics have to be granted. On the one hand, the system has to be universal in the sense that it must cover all the judges in the country, and on the other hand, it has to be a centralized system so as to make sure that the central authority is responsible for the whole system. A digital system that works correctly has many advantages for all the court users. Parties can be notified by email or SMS. Courts can have a direct and quick relation with banks, for instance, for freezing accounts. There will be the cooperation in civil and criminal cases can be fostered internationally. And documents, the digitization of documents saves money in printing and allows a quicker and safer transfer and storage of these documents. But to have a system that works efficiently, counsels for the judiciary have to be involved. A judge is not an expert in IT systems. Therefore, individual and accessible support to each judge has to be provided to him or her to solve the problems that may arise as quickly as possible. The judge must also be provided with an electronic signature included in a personal document assuring data protection. A judge needs to have access to databases containing legislation and case law, and the new IT technologies will foster the networks among judges, permitting that important legal reforms or relevant judgments are sent to all the judges interested in them. As to the increase of the transparency, the websites of the Councils for the Judiciary have become an important instrument to enhance transparency and therefore to increase the trust and confidence in the judiciary. In that sense, these websites publish the composition of the courts and its different chambers, the rules of allocation of cases, the authorizations given by the councils to each single judge, for instance, compatibilities for teaching, etc. As to the third objective, the interoperability of the different IT systems that converge in a judicial systems, councils for the judiciary have to make sure that these systems are compatible. Otherwise, exchanging judicial documents within the same country from one region to another would become impossible. For this region, we come to agreements with other administrations, for instance, the ministries of justice or regional authorities, so that we are aware that this system works. In the same way, judicial documents have to circulate safely and quickly within the European Union. The European Commission has started a project under the name eCodex, where citizens, businesses, and governments are involved so that documents can be improved, this cross-border exchange in a safe, accessible, and sustainable way. This is a project CCPA knows well, since it is a partner to it. The last aim for judicial councils are the security of the whole system. A huge amount of information is made available by digitalization of the judicial document, and this information is sensitive, so we have to make sure that EU and national legislation on data protection of individuals is respected. To my second part of my intervention, the changes in the way we all work. If we want to have timeliness justice and we want to work in a digital context, some changes in the way we all work will have to be introduced in the midterm. Legislation and case law databases facilitate the search of the laws or cases we want to quote in our documents, but sometimes we do not make the effort to resume the most important elements of them, we just copy. This makes writings in some cases extraordinarily long and difficult to understand, and in a digital environment, we have to keep in mind that the judge will no longer work with a written document. He will work on a screen, so our documents have to be better made up. For instance, by numbering the different paragraphs, introducing an index, using the European case law identifier to identify judgments, etc. And the oral hearing should become more and more important. In that sense, I will draw your attention on the experience of the Court of Justice of the European Union, which I find is very valuable. Looking ahead, it is likely that more and more dispute resolution will be conducted online. Judges may be required to communicate with parties by email in order to avoid the inconvenience and expense of unnecessary court hearings. This will be particularly useful in low-value cases where parties are deterred from asserting their rights by the cost of the court's proceeding. But there will always remain cases which can only be properly resolved by a face-to-face court hearings. And I'm coming to the last part of my intervention, still sticking to the same old values. In 1997, the Indian writer Arundhati Roy published a novel with the title The God of Small Things that shows the importance small things have in the behavior of people. Digitization will not be the solution to all the problems of the justice system if we forget that this system is served by persons and if we do not care about the small things that make the big difference. Judges have to be independent, accountable, and impartial. We need judges that in these new times stick to the same values as their predecessors. We need judges that fulfill their duties under ethical criteria. The complexity of the art of judging means that many virtues or quality must be combined so that justice can be done. Confidence in justice is not only guaranteed by an independent, impartial, honest, competent, and diligent judge. A judge should perform his role with wisdom, loyalty, humanity, courage, seriousness, and prudence, while having the capacity to listen, communicate, and work. Let me conclude by saying that the success of digital justice will be the result of a combined effort of all the stakeholders involved in judicial proceedings. As to the counsels for the judiciary, we are optimistic. During our last ENCJ General Assembly, we did an online survey to all participants and to the question, I believe that in 2035, the efficiency, quality, and independence of national justice system will have improved substantially. 98.5% of the participants agreed. I also agree and hope you agree too. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for the judiciary's point of view you gave us, which is very important. And now, Mr. Jérôme Dupré, co-founder of Case Law Analytics.
Thank you. Merci. Je m'exprimerai en français. D'abord, je tiens à remercier Monsieur Bénichoux pour son invitation, l'invitation du CCBE. Alors, ce que je souhaiterais d'abord, c'est dire que nous sommes également ravis de cette approche humaniste qui a été évoquée par Monsieur Bénichoux et nous la partageons. C'est pas parce qu'on s'intéresse à la technique qu'on perd notre humanité. Et qu'on met ça de côté, c'est quelque chose d'important. Nous sommes aussi très heureux que le garde des Sceaux ait cité les travaux que nous menons sur les licenciements et les prestations compensatoires. C'est quelque chose qui n'est pas un projet, mais qui fonctionne d'ores et déjà. Voilà. Donc, le contexte, alors, il est global au niveau mondial, mais en France, j'ai ressorti une infographie qui était sur le journal Le Monde il y a quelques jours. Le budget de la justice, c'est le petit carré vert en bas à gauche. Je trouve que c'est très parlant. Alors, il y a eu des efforts très substantiels qui ont été faits par le garde des Sceaux, et je trouve que c'est quelque chose de très important à souligner. Néanmoins, on part d'assez loin. Raymond DeVos, dans une de ses prestations, disait « trois fois rien, c'est déjà quelque chose ». Bon, là, on a un vrai effort, mais c'est vrai qu'on part de très loin et que peut-être un jour, on pourra espérer un plan pluriannuel pour avoir une augmentation du budget de la justice, ce qui veut dire que ça doit traverser les différentes périodes politiques et être un choix qui traverse les différents clivages. Il y a un auteur d'un ouvrage qui s'appelle Jean-Claude Farcy, qui a publié en 2015, ça fait pas très longtemps, c'est quelqu'un qui travaillait dans un laboratoire associé au CNRS. Il a travaillé sur les effectifs de magistrats, il allait consulter les registres il y a deux siècles. Et on trouve dans ses travaux qu'il y a autant de magistrats qu'il y a deux siècles en France, alors que la population a plus que doublé. Je crois que c'est aussi quelque chose d'important à souligner parce qu'on compare souvent la situation en France avec les différents pays européens, mais par rapport à notre propre histoire, on est aujourd'hui en retard. Alors, je vais vous parler d'intelligence artificielle, mais d'abord, je voudrais vous donner quelques éléments de contexte. Je suis parti, ça fait quelques années, assister à une conférence sur les Online Dispute Resolution Services à San Francisco. J'avais fait le déplacement, il y avait beaucoup d'Européens, pas de Français. Et Bon, maintenant, ça va peut-être changer. L'année prochaine, il y aura une réunion sur ce sujet qui va être organisée par la CCI en juin prochain. Voilà, mais un certain nombre d'acteurs s'intéressent de très près à ces sujets, les assureurs de protection juridique. Nous étions à Montréal il y a quelques jours pour aborder ces sujets-là. Eux ont bien compris les enjeux qu'il y avait. Voilà, on a envisagé il y a quelques années l'arrivée de l'email dans les cabinets d'avocats, M. Suskin. Bon, on sait qu'aujourd'hui, tout le monde utilise l'email dans les cabinets. On n'a pas peut-être encore complètement des cabinets totalement dématérialisés, mais on y viendra peut-être, parce qu'on peut espérer que dans quelques années, on n'ait plus besoin nécessairement de locaux lorsqu'on est avocat, et puis qu'on puisse travailler avec un développeur pour imaginer de nouveaux logiciels. Mais bon, c'est un sujet... Alors le contexte, c'est également le big data et sa version publique, l'open data, qui modifie les pratiques parce qu'on peut extraire aujourd'hui une quantité de données extrêmement importante pour les faire parler. C'est aussi les Online Dispute Resolution Services qu'on voit apparaître aux USA, au Royaume-Uni, aux Pays-Bas, qui est un pays qui est très avancé. Effectivement, c'est peut-être pas un hasard si l'Innovating Justice est implanté là-bas. L'arrivée de la Legal Tech, on a des associations motrices comme le National Center for, alors je sais plus, c'est Dispute Resolution, qui organise ces salons annuels sur les ODR. On a l'association Open Law qui est très très active en France. Voilà, on a des technologies identifiées comme l'assemblage automatique de documents, l'intelligence artificielle, je vais y revenir. L'année dernière, on a eu d'importantes levées de fonds aux États-Unis, entre 5 et 10 millions d'euros pour beaucoup d'entreprises qui arrivent dans la Legal Tech. Après, le FinTech, c'est un domaine qui est en train de bouger très fort. Et il va y avoir un premier salon en France dans les prochaines semaines, les 16 et 17 novembre 2016. Alors, voilà, ça, ce sont les, j'ose pas dire les concurrents des avocats, mais il va falloir faire avec. On a par exemple une société comme LegalZoom qui vient de racheter un cabinet important à Londres il y a quelques jours. J'ai appris ça voilà, à l'occasion d'un déplacement et ils sont très très actifs. Ils sont une sorte de porte d'entrée. Et donc vous savez ce que c'est la génération automatique de documents. On rentre un certain nombre de champs et on a un document alors qui n'est pas forcément parfait, qu'il faut sûrement relire, qu'il faut sûrement compléter avec une expertise. Mais ça, aujourd'hui, ça marche très fort. Certaines de ces sociétés, d'ailleurs, je crois, ont eu des petits soucis avec certaines instances du barreau, ont été poursuivies. Mais voilà, aujourd'hui, il y a véritablement une explosion de ces technologies. On a aussi les plateformes ODR. Alors, l'un des représentants de HiiL Innovating Justice citait, je ne sais pas ce que valent ces chiffres, Alibaba qui explique résoudre 1 million de litiges par jour de manière automatisée. C'est Jinho Verdonshot qui m'a donné cette information, ce qui a de quoi effectivement faire réfléchir. Vous avez des entreprises comme Modria, Ustich, la plateforme proposée par HiiL, HiiJust, FastArbitre, qui sont des plateformes d'arbitrage. Les ODR, les Online Dispute Resolution, c'est quelque chose qui était le thème du dernier colloque qu'il y a eu à La Haye, au Palais de la Paix, les 23-24 mai. On avait beaucoup de magistrats. On avait le président de Modria et on avait aussi un représentant du ministère de la Justice anglais qui travaille sur ces sujets. Si vous voulez vous faire une idée de l'importance des ODR, vous allez sur Amazon ou n'importe quelle autre, j'ai dit Amazon, mais ça peut être n'importe quelle autre librairie en ligne et vous tapez Online Dispute Resolution. Vous allez voir, il y a des dizaines d'ouvrages qui sortent, dont certains font plusieurs centaines de pages et qui font complètement autorité aujourd'hui. Donc intéressez-vous à ces sujets, il y a de vrais enjeux. Les robots. Eh bien, aujourd'hui, on a des chatbots, notamment un juriste automatisé qui a fait annuler 160 000 amendes de stationnement à Londres et à New York. Vous avez un article du Guardian que vous pourrez aller consulter et qui a un taux de succès, je crois, des 2/3. C'est peut-être pas assez. Alors, en intelligence artificielle, il y a des systèmes qu'on combat, notamment en matière pénale. Il faut savoir que dans plus d'une vingtaine d'États américains, on a maintenant un système qui s'appelle Evidence-Based Sentencing. Et là, c'est exactement ce qu'on souhaite éviter, nous, parce qu'on rentre des données un peu simplistes, comme le code postal, mais on ne se rend pas compte à quel point un code postal peut être quelque chose de très discriminant, parce que voilà, il y a des endroits où il y a peut-être plus de délinquance. Et donc, ça enquisse les situations, ça les cristallise, et il faut éviter ça. Parce qu'on finit par se prononcer sur la base d'un risque théorique, et ça va à l'encontre de nos principes fondamentaux en matière de justice. Les conséquences de ces évolutions, quelles sont-elles? Alors, les tarifs sont tirés vers le bas, et c'est déjà une réalité. Il y a eu des études sérieuses qui le montrent, alors que la demande de justice ne croît pas nécessairement. Et les professions du droit vont être contraintes de se transformer à travers éventuellement du recours à la sous-traitance pour des fonctions basiques, de recherche ou autres. et puis surtout avec la technologie qui ne devient plus une option, mais qui est véritablement une nécessité pour les avocats qui veulent continuer à défendre leurs marges. Voilà. Et donc Suskind, qui a déjà anticipé un certain nombre de choses, nous dit aujourd'hui les avocats vont devoir se concentrer sur les missions à haute valeur ajoutée. Mais il faut savoir que voilà, il y aura peut-être moins de recrutement d'avocats juniors, il y aura peut-être plus d'avocats qui seront des avocats augmentés, qui travailleront avec des outils technologiques de pointe. Et puis les avocats eux-mêmes vont pouvoir devenir des prestataires de justice, par exemple via l'arbitrage, via des plateformes. Mais il faut à ce moment-là qu'effectivement il y ait un vrai accompagnement de ces start-up du droit. Je crois que l'incubateur du barreau de Paris a commencé à s'intéresser de très près à ces sujets. Voilà. Alors dans le droit, l'intelligence artificielle, c'est quelque chose d'important. On a des acteurs comme Ross, Lex Machina, Ravello. On en a aussi en France. Ça permet d'avoir une... C'est une technologie d'abord qui est fiable, qui a été développée par l'INRIA. Alors, c'est un travail qui est issu d'une amitié avec quelqu'un qui est dans la salle, qui est Jacques Lévy-Véel, qui est directeur de recherche à l'INRIA. Et on utilise des techniques qui servent à quantifier le risque déjà dans différents domaines comme le marketing, le commerce, la finance, mais aussi la médecine. Voilà. Alors, il y a un aléa judiciaire, on le connaît. Le juge Bridois expliquait que dans Rabelais, on jetait les dés, il y avait un aléa judiciaire. C'est une réalité qu'on connaît, hein. Même à la sortie de l'ENM, les résultats des décisions des élèves magistrats ne sont pas les mêmes, et pourtant, elles ne sont pas fausses pour autant. Voilà. Il faut intégrer ces technologies, savoir que la vraie révolution, elle est dans les usages. Clément Ader pensait que le téléphone de Graham Bell servirait pour écouter l'opéra. Bon, on sait ce qu'il en a été. Et dans les domaines juridiques, aujourd'hui, ces technologies, elles peuvent être utilisées par les juges pour constituer une aide à la décision, parce qu'ils peuvent, plutôt que d'aller voir leur père quand ils ont un doute sur un dossier, avoir une idée de ce qui se pratique généralement, dans leur cours ou ailleurs. Ça peut éventuellement aider à une meilleure productivité, à une baisse du contentieux, parce que si on sait qu'on a 10% de chance, ou plutôt 90% de chance de gagner 10 000 euros, on peut peut-être transiger à 9 000. Donc c'est une aide très forte pour ces aspects-là. Ça peut être une harmonisation des pratiques, parce qu'on a constaté des vraies disparités entre les cours d'appel qui ne s'expliquent pas nécessairement. Voilà. Pour les avocats, c'est le moyen d'optimiser leur stratégie. Ça peut être un moyen de convaincre les clients du bien fondé de leur expertise. Ça permet également de convaincre les adversaires d'une position de négociation sur une base rationnelle et fiable, puisqu'on apprend, en fait, on crée des algorithmes et on apprend sur des milliers de décisions et on les teste sur des milliers d'autres de décisions, et ça fonctionne. Et on a une technologie qui a été démontrée mathématiquement par un théorème et qui est vérifiée empiriquement. Ça permet aussi d'exposer aux juges la pratique habituelle de leur pair, donc de les convaincre, et ça permet enfin de gagner du temps et de se différencier de la concurrence. Je dois conclure, donc je dirais que pour les citoyens et pour l'État de droit, c'est aussi un bénéfice. Ça permet d'accéder à la jurisprudence sous une forme nouvelle. Ça permet d'avoir des anticipations fiables et raisonnables. Et ça peut aider à désencombrer les tribunaux sans avoir recours à la déjudiciarisation, puisque les gens sont libres ou pas d'aller au tribunal, mais ils ont une idée de ce qui les attend. Voilà. Et on mène également une réflexion éthique, parce qu'il y a de vrais enjeux éthiques sur ces éléments. Voilà, je conclue en disant que... L'intelligence, c'est aussi savoir s'adjoindre celle des autres. Et de ce point de vue, je ne doute pas que les avocats sauront faire appel à toutes les formes d'intelligence qui existent. Je vous remercie.
Thank you very much, Jérôme Dupré. And now we enter into the discussion. The first question will come from our distinguished guest, the challenger panel. Neil Rose or Bruno Dondero, who will be the first? You have the floor.
The panel has been very optimistic and very positive about digital justice. I suspect that the hardest group to convince will be lawyers who don't necessarily see that their way of working, which has been preserved for so long, should change. How can you persuade the profession to come along, or do they need to be dragged along?
You want to?
Yes. Well, I can talk about my experience as agent for the Kingdom of Spain before the Court of Justice of the European Union. When in 2004, the 10 new member states entered the Union, the court called all the agents and said, listen, this has to come to an end. We can't work on as we have been working for the last 25 years. We have to introduce some changes. And one of the changes was what I mentioned before, shorting the length of the writings, numbering the paragraphs, and making an index. And at the first time, you think this is something I don't want to do. But then you discover that it's very useful. Because in that context, nobody will read the writing in Spanish. It will be translated, so you need the paragraphs. You have to go through the main ideas, so you need the index. You have to introduce certain changes because judges have started now in Madrid, some judges no longer print the documents. They have to work on a screen. They have to take some notes, and in the deliberation chambers, they use also a screen to look at the documents. So we all have to change if we want to have timeliness justice the way we work. This is something I wanted to tell in this room.
We had a great talk earlier today from the president of the Young Lawyers showing that there is a legal profession ready for change and wanting their leaders to embrace change. My experience as a lawyer has never been that lawyers are not creative and that they're conservative. I've seen lawyers in my law firm develop great new instruments. I've worked on 4 or 5 innovations in procedural justice myself with big teams. The problem is that you don't allow lawyers to be creative for helping individual people. It's the rules that restrict creativity and working together with the guys who can solve this problem.
And Mrs. Astola, could we imagine a framework allowing this and the collaboration of all lawyers, young lawyers, judges, administration, EU?
In the EU?
Yeah.
First of all, you have to remember that EU's right to legislate and work is always based on the articles, the legal basis. So procedural law has for a long, long time been a national prerogative. But of course, if I may say something also, I very much like the idea which was mentioned by the presentation in the presentation of the young lawyers, make, launch, fix. That is very problematic if you're working with legal certainty, if you are working with procedural law, and I think that makes it so difficult to develop these IT systems for the judiciary, because we have to be, in a way, more certain than maybe in other fields. But I still think that this is the way we should be going and we should be allowed to fix it. And then as to the lawyers being conservative, I think it's like with everybody else, you have to show the benefits. And when you show the benefits, there is an interest, and then you have to also include lawyers in the work. In Finland, we included in the work the judges, but also the administration of the courts. So not just translating something into a technical language, but changing the way we work and then working with IT.
Okay.
I just want to make one comment from the English experience. There is a huge digital program being started in the English courts, costing £700 million over the next 4 years, not worth as many euros as it was a couple of months ago, obviously. And one of the key recommendations is for an online court for small claims. And initially, the judge, this very senior judge who came up with the recommendation, talked about this new court being completely different, new rules, wouldn't need any lawyers. The legal profession was not happy about that. And suddenly, by his final version of his report, he said actually there would be a role for lawyers, not as big as there would be now, but there is still work, unbundled work is what he said. But the profession will fight back if it sees technology being taking away its work.
Maybe on these big programs which aim for basically a paperless court. And there are small innovations in it. With all due respect, it works if your paragraphs are numbered. But these changes will not do the job for bringing more justice and more equal justice to individuals, which is my perspective. These programs are for making the current legal procedures for what you call high-value claims, I will come to that, for companies and for the law firms serving companies will make it a little bit more efficient. When I look at what is done for individual citizens, and they're talking about low-value claims, about small claims. For these people, these are not low-value problems. In their lives, there are big, big, big problems. That's one. Is there perhaps something wrong with the attitude of the current legal sector if we say these are small claims? You online guys may have them. Is there something behind that, perhaps? My perspective is that I've seen many, many innovations come through during the past 20 years, and there's always the reaction of the traditional profession, let's start with small claims. When you look at what small claims actually are, they are claims, small money claims of people, because personal injury is not included, family justice cannot be included, landlord-tenant, no, there's too much public policy involved, no, cannot be included. So what you have is money claims. Who has money claims? Companies, not individuals. So, yeah, how are we dealing with this? Is this honest innovation? Is this really wanting to grab the new world? Or are we just bringing our files to the computer?
Yeah, you're right. There are also big problems, but it is interesting to inform you that very soon in British Columbia, we will have the first Canada online tribunal, which will have the authority to handle small claims up to $25,000. Online tribunal. Second.
Okay, thank you. I will speak in French. To be more precise and not to give you a taste of my bad English. Je trouve que tout ce qu'on dit ici est très intéressant et c'est bien qu'on ait ce débat parce que le monde va bouger sans nous, les juristes, si on n'y prend pas garde. Donc on est obligé de suivre. Même si on ne le veut pas, on est obligé. Mais c'est quand même assez violent quand on nous dit « let's innovate », par exemple. « Let's innovate », c'est terrible, parce que « créons ». Enfin, pour créer, il faut être prêt à créer, il faut avoir l'idée qui nous vient, mais il faut qu'on crée, il faut qu'on innove. Mais le juriste, jusqu'à présent, et pendant assez longtemps, je crois, pouvait assez tranquillement, enfin, avait déjà les mains pleines, il avait le droit à connaître ce qui n'était pas une mince affaire, et depuis une période qui est quand même très récente, tout d'un coup, notre monde est en train d'être révolutionné. Et il y a une observation qui me vient, qui est que la révolution, elle est qu'avant, il y avait ce qui était dans le droit, on savait qu'on rentrait dans le monde juridique avec les avocats, les magistrats, et il y avait ce qui était hors du droit. On allait négocier, on allait régler les choses comme ça, rapidement, entre nous. Et c'est vrai que c'est le numérique, en réalité, qui permet de créer une zone intermédiaire. Quand on parle des online dispute resolution, par exemple, c'est vrai que c'est bien l'idée de se dire qu'on va pouvoir régler sans se déplacer, sans aller au tribunal, sans le rituel judiciaire qui coûte finalement cher aussi et qui nous oblige à attendre. On va pouvoir régler plein de questions. Mais c'est vrai qu'on a toute une zone intermédiaire qui apparaît pour peut-être des petits litiges, mais vous le dites justement, des litiges qui, pour les personnes qui les vivent, ne sont pas des petits litiges. Et on a toute cette zone qui apparaît, qui est-ce que c'est encore du droit, du vrai droit avec de la vraie justice? Est-ce que c'est une zone intermédiaire? Et ça, c'est une révolution qui, pour les juristes, à vivre, est quand même assez difficile. Alors, le discours qui est wake up, par exemple, bon, l'expression est juste, il faut toujours être en éveil, mais voilà, je ne suis pas sûr que les juristes dormaient jusqu'à présent, simplement ils doivent maintenant, pas tous, voilà, en tous les cas, ils doivent maintenant suivre une partie, enfin, ils doivent suivre maintenant une évolution. Et voilà, il y a 10 ans, on n'y pensait pas forcément. Ça implique des choses différentes en termes de formation, en termes de formation continue des juristes. Et c'est, voilà, c'est une révolution comme peut-être les juristes n'en avaient jamais connue depuis, depuis Justinien, peut-être.
Ouais. C'est vrai ?
Ouais. I think there's a lot to add, but I think one has to remember, which was said, I think, by the president, that we have gone through of all kinds of new things, and I would think that the European law as itself is one of them. I remember when studying, people studied law in order not to have to study languages, and what you have to do now is study languages and law, European law.
I can propose to give to it one question from you, and to give to the audience the possibility for one more question, and then we will have a coffee break. Yeah.
One more question, maybe I will do it in English if you allow me. Yeah, maybe it's Lawrence Lessig, you know, the Harvard professor quote, which is very famous, which is, "Code is law." And code is law, it's a very simple idea that people today put a lot of law and a lot of legal issues in the computer. And when we're hearing that Amazon or any platform is treating millions of litigations a day, it's the idea that I was bringing forward before. It's there is a lot of justice that we don't see anymore because it's in the computer resolution. But the question is it still justice? And are you being given all of your rights by the computer? Thank you.
Yeah, I've been working when I was a student about the same time that I wanted to start that small law firm. I've worked on a project predicting decisions on release of prisoners after 2/3 of their sentences, and the idea of what code could do to the legal world has always been. Let's automate decisions. Yeah, that's not what I believe in and what most of us believe in. We all say and think it's very, very human. What can code do, what we try to do on online platforms is to bring people together. Facebook is not putting code instead of human relationships. Online dispute resolution is not putting code together to solve problems. It's about bringing people together and let them cooperate, including the lawyers, to build solutions that last for the next 60 years. We work on divorce. My grandparents were divorced. The effects of that in my family are still felt today, and it was poorly done. We can bring so much more value to people's lives if we really start appreciating what order and rules and structure can bring into people's lives with modern techniques designed from the perspective of the user, not designed from what we can allow others to do in the legal field. No, let's innovate from what the user needs. We do that in big law firms. My law firm starts looking at the needs of big companies. Why can't that happen for the needs of individuals?
Jérôme. Systems, is it justice what they can provide?
Je vais répondre en plusieurs étapes. Ce qu'on dit depuis le début sur finalement le débat entre l'homme et la machine, hein, c'est une vraie question. Bon, il y a des inquiétudes et elles sont légitimes, d'autant que la justice, elle a d'une certaine manière deux objectifs contradictoires. Elle doit traiter de façon égale, il y a une égalité devant la loi, tous les citoyens, ça c'est un axe horizontal, et de façon verticale, elle doit traiter chaque justiciable en tenant compte de toutes les spécificités de son dossier. Et c'est cette contradiction fondamentale qu'il faut arriver à résoudre. Bon, il n'y a pas de recette miracle. On a essayé, enfin, ça fait depuis un certain temps qu'il y a une réflexion sur les barèmes. Bon, les barèmes, c'est une façon de traiter tout le monde de façon égale. Il faut savoir que, bon, il y a un peu une résistance à l'installation de barèmes. Sans barème, c'est dangereux parce que ça peut être n'importe quoi. Avec un barème, ça peut aussi être n'importe quoi. Donc, il faut arriver à trouver des solutions. L'apport de l'intelligence artificielle par rapport à ça, d'abord, elle ne prétend pas l'intelligence artificielle remplacer l'humain, c'est absolument pas une option aujourd'hui. Je pense qu'on a besoin de l'expertise humaine. Mais on peut travailler sur beaucoup, beaucoup de critères d'entrée. Par exemple, une trentaine. Donc, par exemple, pour une prestation compensatoire, on peut entrer la durée du mariage, le patrimoine, les revenus, les charges, le nombre d'enfants, etc. Et ça, avec un barème, c'est compliqué à faire, parce qu'on est dans des systèmes de régression linéaire, tandis qu'avec l'intelligence artificielle, on peut pallier presque, et même c'est le cas, l'absence de données pour avoir un modèle mathématique robuste, mais Jacques en parlerait mieux que moi, en sautant une étape, finalement. Mais on vérifie que ça fonctionne. Donc ça permet d'avoir un premier niveau. Après, il est évident qu'il faut laisser, surtout quand les enjeux sont importants financièrement, humainement, une liberté d'appréciation à l'humain. De toute façon, c'est dans cette interaction que l'humain se grandit. C'est pas en étant remplacé par une machine, surtout quand les enjeux sont très importants.
I think we can take one question from the public if there is an interested too, please.
Yes, we don't
have... There is a micro.
Hello, it's Ian Mitchell here. I've been asked to do a sort of rapporteur thing when the publication comes out, but it sets some thoughts going. The pie chart was very revealing because it had the... In 2035, 95% of lawyers think the world will be a wonderful place. It's a little bit like the Victorian myth of progress. All changes necessarily for the better. And it does remind me of the what was said about the law well over 100 years ago, that the law is like the Ritz Hotel. It's open to everyone. It seems to me that we've been talking about the IT, but more and more I come to realize there's a scope for public policy here. And if the public policy isn't right, there's dangers ahead of us. And in particular, the wonderful IT we're getting to increase efficiency, it would be nice to think it's about giving better law. I suspect at governmental level, perfectly consistently, it's about giving greater financial efficiency, and that's good. But what is not so good, and you see it in Scotland and in England, is the increase in fees for civil justice fees for accessing the courts, which when small people have quite large claims, it makes it very difficult for them even to get into court. But for the company they're suing, the bank they're suing, it's a peccadillo. There's a pressure to remove legal aid. In Scotland, it's not too bad, but in England, legal aid has been removed from vast swathes of work that would affect private individuals. I, as an English barrister, do some direct access work, which is without the assistance of a solicitor. It's very difficult, and you have small people, and you're under-resourced. So it seems to me that if we, and there's proposals to increase court fees in Scotland too, seems to me that if you don't get the public policy right, what's going to happen is people who need lawyers, be they big firms or small firms who want to help people, will just not be able to do it because the public policy stands in the way. And what will happen? There's still a need, it's an unmet need, and all of the individuals and small firms and others who should be coming seeking justice have got to go to LegalZoom and the right. Now, it might be cheap and nasty and dirty, but it gives them something, and something is better than nothing. So all this wonderful technology, if we don't get the public policy right, will only make things worse and not better. The public policy will drive people away from lawyers. Lawyers, of course, should be ready to adapt, but I wonder what the panel thinks about the public policy aspect.
Thank you, Ian. Ian Mitchell is the chair of our committee of surveillance in CCB. It's, I think he told everything he said. Okay, I would.
But maybe to say about legal aid that the European Commission has worked for legal aid, but it is very different in different member states. And at the same time as some member states have been lowering the coverage, there are others that have increased it, and some member states have lowering the pay to the or the limit to the lawyers. Some have increased it, so it's not. It is public policy issue, and of course, ideal would be that we could raise it within the European Commission as a whole.
We are working, we have no time, I'm informed now. I would like to thank all of you, all the participants, and coffee break.
Thank you very much.
We had the problem. Thank you.